Hey there, it's Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and today we are at the Nuclear Fuel Lab.
So there are several people, different works and projects done in this lab, but we're going to talk a little bit more about what I'm doing. So of course, since it is a nuclear fuel lab, we start with uranium, right? So I'm going to show you a little bit how natural uranium metal looks like. So this is basically a container, a plexiglass container that has several pieces of natural uranium that we're going to see up close in a while. The reason why I'm holding it like this and I'm not really afraid of it is, first of all, because as I said, it is natural uranium, meaning that its radioactivity is quite low, similar to the background radiation. And second of all, as we know or don't know and can learn right now, is that natural uranium is primarily an alpha emitter, which means that its radiation comes primarily from alpha particles. And as we know, they are heavy particles and they are mostly stopped at a few millimeters, let's say, distance. So even the aluminum foil or the paper would stop them. The beta radiation would mostly be stopped from the thick plexiglass that contains the pieces inside, and then what is left is a small amount of gamma radiation, which is of course traveling inside the environment. But as I said already, this is a natural element and it is as it exists in nature, hence the level of radioactivity that it has, it's quite low. So with proper handling, there is no fears to treat such materials as long as you know what you're doing. So we can now see up close how natural uranium metal looks like. You can trust me when I say it doesn't really look any different from any other dirty metal, in a sense. But it's uranium, so it's more interesting. Here it is. This is basically metal, so it would be how we take it basically from the ground after being cleaned and with the excess elements that were attached to it being removed. It is still quite dirty. When we use it, we usually clean it with nitric acid, ethanol and acetone, and then it looks pretty shiny. I can put a picture up there so you can see how it looks after cleaning. But yeah, right? You would never know that this is uranium. Let's find out if it actually is. So probably our favorite equipment in the lab is the Geiger counter. So pretty typical low levels when I'm not aiming it at anything. Now, so it's around 500 microsievert per hour, which of course it's much higher than the background radiation, but as I said, still not within any extremely high level that would need any specific handling of the fuel, like for example we do with spent nuclear fuel. So let me know if that's how you expected uranium to look like. So when you're working with uranium-bearing samples, even if it is for demonstration purposes or you actually have some work to do with them, you always want to mark your area in case of a spillage or some sort of, let's say, contamination, something falls out. So you always want to put something down in case something spills. You know that it is in your paper or it is in the territory that you have marked that you are working on, and you don't need to, let's say, decontaminate the whole table or something like that. So I find it interesting how uranium can exist in different forms, and that's why I wanted to show you a couple more. So we all know probably the yellow cake, which I'm going to put a picture up here, which is basically uranium dioxide in the fabrication process before it becomes a pellet for the typical light water reactors. We don't have such in the lab. However, we have all kinds of different other uranium containing, let's say, powders and pellets, because other people are working on several projects, as I said. This is uranium tetrafluoride, and I don't work with this element. It's just interesting how the color looks like, right? It's a powder. And getting back to our topic of pellets, these are typical uranium dioxide pellets in size and shape that you would find in light water reactors around the world. What is interesting and might not be common knowledge about the fuel pellets is that while they're being, let's say, while they're fissioning inside the reactor core, they're actually expanding. So the tendency of the pellets to expand is pretty much from the top and the bottom, and they become like a barrel. So for that reason, when they are being manufactured, they are being chamfed, as it's called, from the top. So basically, a dish size, let's say, and shape of the pellet is being cut off. So the initial pellet looks with a little bit of a dent from the top and the bottom. And this is done on purpose because, as I explained, when it's going to go inside the reactor and it's going to be, let's say, fissioning and creating all of these fission products, it's going to expand. And the idea is that eventually it will reach a perfect cylinder size and not go over that in order to touch the pellets above and create some strain or mechanical, let's say, stress on the pellet and the cladding itself. The manufacturer of these pellets in Europe is Westinghouse, and actually Westinghouse is a manufacturer in the US as well. There is a US company, Westinghouse, and a same, let's say, daughter company in Europe, which provides all the fuel for the European reactors, some Asian reactors, and some reactors in the US as well. Therefore, they are pretty standardized in size and shape to match the reactors that they are manufactured for. And as I said, this is pretty much a realistic pellet that it's actually inside a reactor. So you can imagine that there is several pellets in a row and they're all covered in a cladding tube. So the cladding tubes are pretty narrow and pretty small in size. And then a lot of cladding tubes together with pellets inside form what we call a fuel assembly, which usually looks either round or square. And the fuel assemblies are the ones that are placed around the reactor core. We're going to see an innovative fuel, which is uranium nitride fuel, and this is the one that I'm working with. So what we see here is a glove box. So what it is, basically a box, like a big container, that inside of it has an atmosphere that is different from oxygen. That's why we're using it. If we, let's say, didn't have a need to have a different atmosphere, there would be no need for these kind of expensive equipment. So inside the glove box, one can feel any gas that is necessary for one's work. In our case, we want an inert gas, a gas that doesn't interfere with any of our samples and doesn't interact with them in any way, like oxygen does, which oxidizes the samples. And that's why our glove box is filled with argon. So here we can, let's say, save our pellets or our powders or any other material that is prone to oxidation. And we can take it out in case we need to do some testing or characterization on it. However, its resting place and its house is inside the glove box. Moving on to take something out, it passes through this tube, which needs to be flushed on the outside, meaning that the oxygen needs to be sucked out of it and argon needs to be introduced to it. And that's done several times to ensure that the tube is quite clean. Then we can open it on the inside, transfer our samples or anything we need to transfer to the outside world. Checking up the gloves again, because as you saw me using the fabric gloves to work in the glove box. And there are several reasons for that. First of all, the fabric gloves are softer, so they are not going to rupture the gloves or create, let's say, any sort of like very harsh tension to them, like your maybe bare hands or nails would. And secondly, when you work for a long time in the glove box, it can get pretty sweaty. It can get pretty warm inside these gloves. So when you try to push rubber gloves inside rubber gloves, it's actually very counterproductive and it doesn't really work that well. Whereas the fabric will absorb the moisture of your hands and will, let's say, eliminate this problem. And if you're wondering, yes, everyone has their own fabric gloves. We don't really use them around. Even though we can, it's not a big problem. So, what I wanted to take outside of the glove box is a uranium nitride pellet. We already saw uranium dioxide pellets, which are sitting outside in the, let's say, lab room. And the reason for that is because they don't really have a big problem of oxidizing since oxygen is already part of the pellet. However, uranium nitride, both powders and pellets, are pretty prone to oxidation since uranium would like the oxygen much more than it would like the nitrogen. So here we see a typical size of a uranium nitride pellet.
which is the fuel that I work with and the fuel that I manufacture here in the lab, starting from the uranium nitride powder. I can talk about the fabrication of the fuel itself in the next video. If that is of interest to you, you can leave a comment down below. However, the two differences that we see with the pellet is, first of all, in terms of color, it doesn't really look that much different from the uranium dioxide that we saw before, and that is true. Second of all, it's much smaller. So it is still a cylinder, but it's maybe one third of the size of the previous one. There is not really a scientific reason for that. It's a more reason of, let's say, preserving resources. And this is because, as I said, we manufacture our own powder in the lab. And for testing and characterization purposes, we don't really need a very big pellet. So it would be pretty much a waste of powder and a waste of uranium to just make very big pellets to do a small testing or a characterization that requires millimeters or even micrometers of area on the sample. Therefore, very small samples that we can still characterize and treat are better in order to save up more powder for the future. And you might see a difference here, which you didn't see in the previous pellet, is the fact that the surface of this pellet is very shiny. And this is actually what a surface looks like when we would like to characterize the pellet. So characterization means that we can see the microstructure of the pellet, we can see the different elements, the different phases that exist inside the pellet. And in order to do that, we use different devices. So one of the equipment that we use would be microscopes, different kinds of microscopes, from optical microscopy to electron microscopy, and go to different, let's say, resolutions. The better the resolution you want, the better need to your sample to be prepared in order for you to see these good resolutions. So this is what we call polishing of the sample, and it needs to be mirror shine in order for you to be able to see good quality imaging under the microscope. So now that we are done with the pellet, we are going to pass it again in the glove box. Since the pellet itself will also be prone to oxidation, and the more it sits outside, it will actually form an oxide layer on it, which will then again needs to be ground off and polished in order for the pellet to be, let's say, used for another testing or characterization technique. So now, since the small tube has been opened on the outside, it is filled with oxygen, and in order to open it on the inside, one would need to flush again to make sure that this tube is filled with argon before opening it on the inside in order to not contaminate the environment of the glove box. And as with anything in science, statistics is important. So we don't just flush the tube one time, we flush it three times or sometimes even up to six times if it's necessary to ensure that all the oxygen from the tube has been taken out. So this is the second time and one last time. Now, you might be wondering, how do you get big equipment inside the glove box? So there is two ways, actually, to do that. If the equipment is, let's say, of a medium to big size, so basically a size that would fit in here, this is the same kind of tube like the small one that we use right now, but it is much bigger. So, for example, the scale or these kind of containers would fit through here. But the biggest question might arise of how do you put this very big machine inside the glove box? So for these purposes, one needs to remove the glass that surrounds the box and take it all out, place the machine inside and close it back. However, of course, this would remove the argon inside the glove box and will fill everything with oxygen. So then a very good purification is needed and a long time before actually you're certain that argon is again inside the glove box and no oxygen is present. And here it is again in its natural environment. Make sure it's well sealed so there's no leaks, and we are done. I hope you enjoyed this video in a day in the lab and a day into my work. Let me know in the comments down below what else would you want me to show and talk about during my work in this lab. Don't forget to like and subscribe and leave a comment down below with your thoughts about this visit and future visits as well. It's been Elina, your friendly nuclear physicist, and until next time, see you soon.